My basic pitch is about why we need a strong RMA, and indeed Local Government Act, EE's legislation and other, if we're to stand any chance of reinventing paradise. Next slide, please. I'm going to deal with this in four ways. I'm going to talk about slow growth, or slow, as I call it, the government's economic strategy, try to address that. Then I will pick up some challenges from that, and then at the end offer some hope. Next slide, please. As you see from this slide, apart from the rather nasty contraction during the global financial crisis, our trade partners' growth has been holding up pretty well and is due to hold up well out to 2015. That's, of course, more of an Australian and Asian European one, but there's no problem for demand out there for what we do. Next slide, please. But here, you will see this Reserve Bank chart plotting each of the recoveries of recession from over six recessions. You can see the growth track out from the bottom point of those recessions. And you'll see on the dotted line there that this is the slowest recovery that we've had in post-war years. And that's no surprise of the troubles of financial crisis, how slow it is to come back from that. Next slide, please. So this is the picture for New Zealand, again, a Reserve Bank chart. On the lower chart, you see the tail end of our longest boom in 60 years. Then you see our deepest recession and longest recession for years, and then you see very tentative and slow recovery from it. Above that is the impact of the rebuilt Christchurch. Again, this is all Reserve Bank figures. And you can see that peaking in 2015, that contributes the lion's share of the city. And by about 2014 or 15, growth having peaked at around 2.8% overall, then starts to drift back very quickly to its long-term average of less than 2%. Next slide. What's going on is we have a very constrained economy. So our ability to grow our economy faster is very constrained by the nature of activity we do. So the primary sector is part of the economy. It's obviously a very large part of our exports, but it's very difficult to grow the volume of those exports rapidly, and it's very difficult to grow the value of them. Yes, there'll be some tick in commodity prices, that won't go on escalating forever. And we do find it very difficult to move the our economy on fast. Next slide. Indeed, here you can see that slow growth of export volume. And in fact, worse than this, in the dairy industry, which is the lion's share of those primary exports, is very resource constrained. So if you look at pretty much every water catchment in the country, it's already almost fully allocated, or indeed, in some cases, over-allocated on water. It's already very fully loaded in terms of nutrients as well. So real pressures are mitigated against pushing back on demands to grow further faster. Next slide, please. So here we see our net international result. And as we saw yesterday from the current account figures, and that current account is growing, and then translates into what we owe the rest of the world. So we're heading back towards about our net international liabilities being about 85% of GDP, which is one of the highest net international liabilities of any of the developed countries. Next slide, please. So that's now I'm going to talk about the it's 30 growth agenda in its 4.5 years in government is this one, the business growth agenda. And the government's simple view is that if it can deliver more export markets, more innovation, more skills in the workplaces, more from capital markets, more natural resources, more infrastructure, if it can play its role in doing that, then economic growth can accelerate. The problem is that only will deliver incremental growth in our existing business models, which I've already shown are very constrained. So you could deliver as much natural resources as you wanted, but we can't because they're not there, particularly for the dairy industry. And you would have a very moderate impact at best on growth. But anyway, the government's whole view is that if it loosens up all what it believes is holding back the flow of these ingredients to business, then the New Zealand economy will accelerate. Next slide, please. I won't dwell on the detail here, but we'll find a way to make this PDF available to you. But the simple point I want to make here is that the simple maths of trying to grow the economy this way doesn't work. And I'm focusing here particularly on the primary sector. But opening up more of these resources and seriously disrupting the balance between the economy and the environment, the simple maths of that doesn't deliver the growth the government is seeking. Next slide, please. So here are some challenges that flow from this. Next slide, please. The most remarkable story I've run across about economic development occurred last year, and that's not just in a New Zealand context. I'm drawing on my 38 years experience so far as a business journalist. But here's the story. Essentially, one Fonterra plant in New Zealand makes infant formula for Pfizer, the US pharmaceutical company. It's a bit more complicated. Some stuff comes from other plants, but think one plant. Pfizer has an 8% share of the Chinese market for infant formula, and it has that by accident. It never wanted to be in the infant formula business. It got into it because it made two big pharmaceutical acquisitions and some infant formula businesses came with it. So it wanted to get rid of them. And it put them up for sale last year. And Nestle, the world's largest food producer, paid $12 billion for that business. So what did New Zealand farmers get out of that? They got commodity price for the milk they sold to Fonterra for that infant formula. Fonterra was paid a small amount of money by Pfizer for processing it and putting it in Pfizer-branded, other brands, its own brands, cans and packages. And then the rest of the value accrued downstream. There's more to Pfizer than that Chinese business, but not much more. And that was the real attraction to Nestle. That $12 billion is three times Fonterra's net asset value. So one deal, of which the New Zealand farmer and Fonterra were a very small part at the front end of that, led to that value creation. So that's the heart of the problem with the New Zealand economy. We say glibly we are commodity producers, that's true, but we rarely stop to think what the impact of that is in terms of how much value is created downstream from what we do and how much value is then captured by other people downstream. This is what we need to turn around, and there is very little in the government's economic strategy or indeed in the corporate strategy of Fonterra to address that issue. So that's the biggest challenge of all from a corporate point of view. Next slide, please. The second challenge is around urban New Zealand. So we focus a lot on the impact of the RMA on rural New Zealand, but I think it's really important we need to consider the urban aspect of it too. And again, we think narrowly in an urban context of housing, but there is an awful lot more to urban form and urban economies we need to work on. The simple fact is our urban environments and our urban economies are in very poor shape. So, for example, in Auckland, only 9% of our economic activity has anything to do with the global economy. Almost all Auckland's economic activity is only engaged with serving the Auckland population. Similarly, Christchurch economy was a mess before the earthquakes, Wellington thought it was going to get rich on tourism and events and the public sector. And a line I use often, and I apologise in a sense to you all down in Dunedin, the Dunedin economy is slipping away gently. And I've had that discussion in Dunedin. I'm prepared, very keen to come back and discuss it some more. But we need to focus very intently on how we reinvigorate and reinvent our urban communities and economies around sustainability issues. Next slide, please. We've got some big work underway in Auckland with our 30-year plan from the council. And again, the RMA is absolutely crucial to this. And the ability for Auckland to run that RMA process, not just on housing, although that's become the flashpoint, but on transport and land use and a whole other host of issues. Next slide, please. Christchurch has many admirable things in the plan for rebuilding the centre of Christchurch, but it's in no way a radical reinvention of what a 21st century city might look like. For example, the rebuild will be to the very low energy efficiency standards that we have in New Zealand. There is no requirement on people to build zero energy houses, for example, which is what people are doing in other countries. There is no economic growth built into this. There is no sustainability bottom lines built into this. And so, you know, fundamentally, it fails the test the government set itself for this plan, which was that the plan was to create a 21st century city. Next slide, please. So in an urban context, the conflict that is getting more intense by the day between what cities in New Zealand want and what the government is prepared to let them have is very intense. So here's the compare and contrast. We want, many of us, compact form. The government wants urban sprawl. We want public transport, the government roads. We want quality urban design. The government talks vaguely about urban guidelines. We want a wide choice in housing. The government is condemning people to affordable housing on the fringe of the city. We want powers to decide and act, but the government, as we see in the RMA 2 discussion paper or the Local Government Act, is bringing ever more power back to the centre. We want enough investment to be able to make this happen. The government is only prepared to give us the limited amount it says it has and then won't let us seek the money elsewhere through the likes of a road tax, for example, in Auckland, or even a fuel tax. We want a new economy. The government wants more of the old economy. We want sustainability. The government talks in this dreadful phrase about economy environment balance. And above all, we want local democracy, not central intervention. Next slide, please. This is a deeply important OECD chart, which shows most of the OECD countries and shows what proportion of money spent locally comes from central government taxation. And as you can see in this chart, we are an absolutely extreme outlier. Rates pay for hardly anything in cities in New Zealand, likewise in the UK and in Ireland, compared with other cities. But if you look down the other end to the right of that scale, you will see that German-speaking countries, particularly Germany and Switzerland, Austria is there, but further up, have a very different approach, where there is a very great deal more central, local region autonomy in terms of what they can do, how they can raise money, how they can spend it, versus central government. And we are extreme versus the German-speaking countries. Next slide, please. So that applies to housing. So this is a housing price inflation chart. Don't dwell on the detail, but what this is showing you is that house price inflation has been extreme in Anglo-Saxon-speaking countries and virtually non-existent in German-speaking countries. Next slide, please. The new executive director of the New Zealand Initiative, which is the think tank, which is the merger of the Business Roundtable and the New Zealand Institute, Oliver Hartwich, originally a German, and he in the UK back in the mid-2000s studied this phenomenon for the policy exchange. And this is a link to the extraordinarily interesting paper that Oliver's done showing how important local control and democracy and control of funds is over the development of urban areas if they're going to function properly. Next slide, please. Our third challenge broadly is this one, which is our oceanic resource. It's huge, the fourth or fifth largest in the world. And we're going to need to develop some fundamentally different science, systems, governance, collaboration with all sorts of other people if we're to stand any chance of using this resource sensibly. There's already extraordinary anomalies in what the government is up to. So for example, out on the Chatham Rise there, bottom trawling has been banned because of damage it does to the seabed, yet the government is about to entertain a resource consent application to seabed mine across that area for phosphate nodules to turn into fertilizer for farming on land. So that's the sort of extraordinary contradiction that is turning up in these the government's chaotic policies on these issues. Next slide, please. Hope. And next slide. There is a Vision 2050 document from the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, and you'll see the link at the bottom of this page. But last year we got the New Zealand version of this, which I highly recommend to you. Next slide, please. And this was some of our best young leaders modelling how New Zealand in 2050 could be home to a very thriving 6 million people, but living within the constraints of the planet. Next slide, please. There is a paradox here. Our opportunities are hugely abundant. And yet, next slide, please. If we focus on the abundant opportunity for commodity products, i.e. let's put on more cows so we can produce more skim milk powder or more whole milk powder, that's the fastest way to poverty. We just can't cope with that environmentally or economically. Next slide, please. Similarly, the fastest way to poverty is to try to reduce these very complex issues to utter simplicity. And that's what the government is up to with this legislation. It's turning its back on our ability to conceive and manage and execute processes to deal with these complexities. Next slide, please. So poverty leads us to that simplicity, which is a very diminished Local Government Act, RMA, and EEZ legislation. Next slide, please. And thus to a very weak view of sustainability. Next slide, please. But here's the paradox. What's really driving great reinvention, great wealth in the world on any issue is about scarcity. So let's apply scarcity to, for example, the dairy industry. Next slide, please. It's about trying to find ways to do something vastly more valuable with the milk from those cows, likes of lactopharmaceuticals or nutrigenomics or bioactives. Next slide, please. It's about strong sustainability, where everything we do is in complete harmony with the ecosystem. I would go further, actually enhances the ecosystem, not just stops damaging it. Next slide, please. And of course, in that paradox, it's about complexity and our ability, next slide, please, to create strong societies locally, nationally, on the basis of very strong democracy and very strong processes like true democracy in the Local Government Act, true exploration of the issues through the RMA and EEZ. Next slide, please. And my last one, almost. That's what's at stake here with this raft of legislation. I very much look forward to joining the discussion on the actual points of it, but very much welcome the opportunity to be able to start with this bigger context. So here's almost my last slide. One of my favorite quotes from Johnny Rotten of the Sex Pistols: you'll have no future if you don't make one for yourself. And one last slide, my favorite view of New Zealand. Thank you very much indeed.